Hi, I'm Kayla.
And I'm Tommy.
And welcome to the Marriage Momentum Podcast.
The goal of this podcast is to help your family flourish by making your marriage whole.
Okay, so last episode, we talked about love and respect, and we said a lot of things that I don't feel like we need to repeat. We need you to go back and listen to that if you haven't already. Because this is going to be probably the two part of three that we're going to discuss how now to implement what we talked about in the last episode. So yes. Please go back and listen to it if you haven't already.
Yeah. And okay. So now that you've listened to it, welcome back. So you'll remember producer Kristen made this really cool picture that sits kind of right in the middle of us two sitting on this couch, and it's representing the crazy cycle. Mm-hmm. So we're rediscovering the love and respect, giving them the practical tools of how do you implement love in your relationship? How do you implement respect? What does that look like? Okay. So the crazy cycle is what most of us fall into. You had that example of the husband and wife couple that were going to celebrate their anniversary. They ended up eating nasty warm up pizza on opposite sides of the house because they blew up and it just happened. And a conversation took off. So you have that crazy cycle. When the man feels disrespected, he withholds love. And love is the very thing that that woman needs in order to survive and thrive in mm-hmm. life.
Yeah.
And when she doesn't feel love, guess what she withholds? Respect. And so then you have this crazy cycle. So today we want to give you those tools to break that crazy cycle.
Break the crazy cycle.
And empower your relationship. Yeah. And so what we're going to focus on, and we need both of you, both spouses, we need the man and the wife to listen to this, okay? We're going to focus on the man's side, but we want it to bring light to how you're thinking, man. And
how you're treating him, wife.
Yeah. So both sides of it. Okay.
Okay. So I think about this like like you're on a mountain and there is a mountain in between you two. You can be, maybe you don't have cell phone reception, but you have walkie talkies. You're talking to each other, but there is a mountain that is standing in between you two. What we're trying to do today is remove the mountain, because when you can completely clearly see each other, you're going to be able to connect. You're going to be able to just really grab a hold of how to treat each other, how to be more respectful, how to be more loving. Let's remove the mountain so that you can connect better.
So more than just hearing their voice, you got to see them.
You got to see.
Move that mountain.
Yes. All right. So we talked about how Emerson Eckert's book dove into how a man feels respected. We're going to just high level talk about this today. So the first one we're going to really hone in on is your, as a man, need to conquer, to have authority in your life. Maybe it also looks a little bit like just like a hierarchy. So let's go ahead and discuss what does that look like for a man? What is their natural drive?
So let's focus on that conquest, that conquering piece of things. Okay. So it's in the base nature of a man. And men, you can agree with this. To be able to hang your hat on something, to be able to put your name on a plaque or whatever the case is, you know, a man going into a conversation, now that I'm about to say this, you will recognize
how many times it happens.
When you meet a new guy, okay, when you introduce yourself, it doesn't have to go very far into a conversation before somebody asks, well, what do you do for a living? Mm-hmm. And so, because a man's sense of belonging and sense of purpose comes with that territory of feeling like they're conquering. Even if you are, I don't know, selling motor oil.
Okay, yeah, sure.
It's that sense of the conquering side of, I'm providing for my family.
Yeah.
I'm making a difference. And I can tell you as a man, like I have struggled, and even if I'm paying the bills, of being like, and what I'm doing is it making a difference in this world? And so that's why you'll have, I don't know, Pepsi saying like, it's a purpose greater than selling drinks. No, it's not. Like their desire is to make money and to sell drinks.
Ultimately.
But what they're doing is they're trying to pull for something greater than that to appeal to that conquest side. And so that's why you have, read stories of World War II. You had 16-year-old boys signing up to lay their life on the line for a purpose greater than themselves. Mm-hmm. It's in a man's nature, that conquest. And within that, it's that sense of service. It's serving a purpose greater than you. But now when that purpose and that service is met with animosity, when it's met with, nitpicking criticism.
Yeah.
It is destructive.
Absolutely.
And we talked about it a little bit last podcast. I mean, dealing with it in the workplace, even. I've had situations where I've made presentations and I've spent weeks on something and there's not anything of like, oh, hey, thanks. It's, hey, on slide 26, you misspelled this word and this and this.
Yeah. It's deflating. Yeah. It's like, okay, I will never build a slide again.
I'll never build a slide again. And so that sense of conquering, that sense of purpose, that sense of accomplishment.
Yeah.
When that is challenged, and okay, so what does that look like from a man's perspective, from the wife? Okay. Of, you know, changing the light bulb, mowing the lawn, maybe getting to the lawn a little too late, or whatever it looks like, it can easily be met. And I want you to expand on this here in just a second. It can easily be met from the wife's side of criticism of, well, maybe if I criticize, I motivate them a little bit more. Mm-hmm. But I can tell you from the man's side of things, it is like, okay, well, you don't like the way I mow the lawn. Watch me not fill the gas in the car again.
Yes. So there is a lot of, times, even in leadership, I've seen this done a lot, not good leadership, bad leadership, will criticize somebody. And in their thought, they're criticizing them to motivate them.
Yeah.
They're thinking, if I say this out loud to them, they will be challenged to do better. And that is extremely toxic. Yeah. I don't want to use that word, but it is like it's damaging. And so wives, you could probably think of so many scenarios, but even when you are at home, nobody is around you. We would never promote this in front of your kids or in front of others. Like, on the contrary, you've got to learn to treat your husband with so much respect that even if it's true, even if he's not respect worthy, or even if he fails in this specific scenario, you've got to learn to acknowledge the things that he does well. And stop trying to constantly tear him apart so maybe he will see the light and do better. He's not going to see the light. And he is probably not going to. I wouldn't think most people, like, I'm sure there is some cases. Every once in a while, people are like, okay, well, I'm going to show them. I'll prove to them I can do it. And I've been there. I have done that before. But most cases, y'all can all relate that that's not effective. When you start, well, we're going to have to get people involved. We need a third perspective, or like, oh, he's never going to be able to do that. And you say it in front of him.
Oh, it's
if he said that to you, first off, most women will fly off the handle,
right?
And they would probably be like, actually, I can do that. But in a man's core desire is to be just obviously respected, but very like the hero.
Yeah.
He wants to be just like, I saved the day. So when you belittle him, it makes him feel stupid, inadequate, ridiculous. And yeah, you're going to get nowhere with that.
So what does that look like in practical terms on the opposite side of empowering? Okay. Because I think this is that we tell people this a lot, that you never have to teach a kid how to lie. You never have to teach a kid how to be disrespectful. It's in our nature.
Yeah.
You know, it's very natural. That's what comes natural. Most of what you see society doing is it just comes natural. Like they do what they want. They do what comes natural. So what doesn't come natural, but it's what's amazing is what's empowering and what's moving and shifting in a relationship starts with little things. Mm-hmm. And so that admiration, that respect side from the wife to the husband, and I can share it from my side of like the times that you have said simple phrases like, thank you for working so hard for our family. Wow. I'm like, how much more can I work? Yeah. You know, there was just something about it. You know, pastor, and I thought it was so funny. It's such a great example, though. He said it from the pulpit. This is a couple years ago, but he had mentioned when he made the bed one time and his wife was like, man, thanks for making the bed. He was like, I'm going to make the bet again. You know, like it's just something
motivated to,
right.
Yeah. I want to do
that. It's recognizing the effort that he's put into it. It's such a simple
recognition.
Word.
I think you just nailed that. Yeah.
It's such a simple word. Thanks for working for our family. Mm-hmm. Thanks for, and it's just a little in passing. You did it even recently. Hey, thanks for all you do. I'm like, I'm going to do more.
Yeah.
It's just that it's that recognition piece, that respect.
Yeah. You feel respected.
Right.
And so wives, just be so careful to not criticize. And I think when we're dating, we dream together when we're dating. We think of like, oh, what the future is going to look like and the house we're going to live in and how many children we're going to have. And, you know, you're thinking of all these things and you and the dating relationship would never laugh in his face and be like, that is ridiculous. Like, no, you will not be able to make that much. Well, you are dumb.
Yeah. And if you did, you probably won't it.
Oh, no, married to that person. He wouldn't want you. Like,
great way to kill your relationship.
Yeah. And you do it often, like just as a woman, it is so natural. And I know I'm generalizing. There is definitely saintly women out there, but it is definitely
well, you're speaking to the natural
for us part of it, to be like, you want to do what? Like, you are old now, friend. Like, your back is going to break. The chiropractor is going to be like totally expensive if you go jump out of that airplane or whatever. Don't criticize. It's not effective and it's not fulfilling. And that is not the way you got him. And that's not the way you're going to keep him.
Yeah. So. That's so true. Okay.
So another word that Emerson Eckert uses specifically is hierarchy. And, you know, it actually is very biblical. And we're not going to go into all of the things that the Bible says about it right now. I'm not sure if we covered it in our last episode or not, but you know, it was God's design ultimately for Adam to not be alone. So he created a wife to help him, but he didn't create Eve and say, all right, Eve, now you go take care of all of the land by yourself and you go do all the chores and you make sure you raise those kids and feed the lions. And while you're at it, go dig up some vegetables for us. Like, I'm going to sit under this tree. It was, no, they worked as a team together. And so the roles that Adam and Eve had, I don't know if they looked much different or not, but I do know that it was very important for Adam to have a job.
Yes.
And it was very important for Eve to come along and help Adam.
She was created for them to fulfill a purpose together.
Together. Right. But Eve was not meant to pull all the weight. And in today's culture, there's a lot of expectations on women. And, you know, like, both are attacked. I'm not going to sit here and say that men aren't attacked. They are so attacked. Every show is about a man being dumb. And all they care about is the way a woman looks, or all they care about is like how, you know, whatever. But women are attacked in the thought that they have to do it all. And men, there has been a lot of men that have taken that and been like, okay, well, she wants to work. She wants to cook. She wants to clean. She wants to, cool, I'm going to let her. And I'm going to, and so he has withdrawn for the fact that he's, you know, maybe he's even in a good nature, like, but now you've got a bunch of men feeling unfulfilled because they don't feel like they have purpose. And the hierarchy of a man is not so that he was not supposed to be the head over the woman so he could lord over her. That's where I was going. A man is supposed to be such the provider, it's so biblical. All throughout the Bible, he's supposed to take care of her and protect. Like, if the bear comes and attacks, he's going to be the one to like die first for the family.
Well, it's leadership. I mean,
absolutely.
That's Christ is the head of the man is the head of the wife. It's a leadership hierarchy. Like you were saying, it's not a lord over.
Okay.
Like it's not that kind of hierarchy. Yes. It is a leadership hierarchy. It is designed by God because of the fall of man. You know, that was what he handed out. Like Eve, like women, you are going to be subject under your husband's leadership, like for the rest of creation. Okay. So now that responsibility is in us. There's that drive, that desire for leadership. And so when you brought up society, it is society, the enemy. Like, yes, let's call it out
absolutely.
How it is. It is the devil's objective to rob men of that leadership in
the
their
purpose.
Home. And he's doing so in, again, here we go in the devil's ways of manipulation, mm-hmm. by being able to try to falsely say that women, you can have all of it. Like you can be, you don't need a man.
Yes.
And like we have watched people say statements like that in a relationship.
Oh yeah. Married.
And
yeah.
It instantly poisons the relationship.
Yeah.
Of, well, I don't need you. Damage instantly. Yes. Like it just, that's yeah. instant destruction of yeah. what you brought in.
Yeah.
Because that's not that hierarchy, that desire to lead is in a man. Okay, so let's talk specifically what if my husband is not leading? Okay, that's a fair point.
And that's fair. That's fair.
That is absolutely yeah, fair.
Happens.
But that's what we've talked about in this respect piece. Rolling over in your mind, it doesn't go back to whether they deserve that respect or not. It's not that, okay, the man is commanded to love his wife unconditionally. That respect piece is supposed to be reciprocated the same way. Mm-hmm. It's not that they deserve respect. It's that you love them and approach them in a respectful way. Manner. First yes. Peter chapter 3 talks about how the wife, through her respectful and pure conduct, can win a man that doesn't even believe in God mm-hmm. over to God.
Yes.
Can completely transform his spiritual man just by her respectful nature.
Yeah.
That doesn't mean you can't have conversations about things that need to be talked about.
No,
maybe some disrespectful,
not at all. Yeah.
Maybe some like not respectful behavior that's happening. You can have those conversations with respect. What's the core of that respect? Humility and love.
Yes. Yes. It's
that's
all
the core
of
those
love.
Conversations.
Like,
yeah.
Even as little as like leaving the toothpaste in the sink. And obviously if that is just, that irks you, it needs to be addressed, but it doesn't have to be like, you are such a slob. That's accusatory. Don't accuse him of being a slob. Maybe he legitimately has no clue that toothpaste is falling. And I think that's the thing, is we get in our mind, how can you not see this? How can you be so dumb? How can you be so yeah. ignorant? How can you, like, because we only see our perspective. And maybe I am hyper aware of how clean that bathroom is. Or maybe I'm hyper aware of, you know, how I talk to people or how intelligently I form my sentences. But when I treat him like he is the dumbest thing ever, or I mean, and obviously this goes both ways. I just feel like it is more in a woman's nature to try to correct and try to make sure everybody's like in line and doing their job right. of like perfectionism, that we're able to call it out so quickly in front of others. And it is damaging, yeah. just like you said.
So in tying into that hierarchy piece is, we've already touched a little bit on it, is that piece of authority. Mm-hmm. You know, in wives, being there to respect that authority of your husband. You know, if you have children, that authority of him as a father in their lives, it will continue to empower him. You know, appreciate his leadership. You know, tell him how much you are thankful of leading the home in prayer, or
yeah.
like leading the children, playing with the children.
Yes.
Like that is a sense of authority, is being able to love your children.
Well, you think know, of and, your the best leadership. And my goodness, I really do feel like Bishop and Pastor are so good about this, of like, I mean, we have known leadership that will call just to correct. And you have no other communication. You have no other sense yeah. of relationship other than that. But when somebody can like joke with you and like even really show their, just be vulnerable, maybe not show all of their sides, but like, but just like be themselves around yeah. you and not feel like that sense of authority, like that you have to portray. You are so much more able to respect those people because, you know, not only are they human, they love me and they care about
right.
me.
Like, right.
And so for a man, it is counteractive to try to force that authority on your family, on your coworkers, on whatever the case may be. If you are not first showing love and vulnerability, and really even just connection.
Yeah.
Because I know a lot of men that they don't feel respected, but have you tried to connect with her in a way that she can respect you? Like she may not even know you. Maybe that's why she can't respect you. But I do feel like that authority piece is so important for you guys. But almost sometimes you can swing the other way of like, I need that authority. I'm going to demand that authority, to where now you're not respect able.
Right.
So it's hard to give the authority.
Yeah. And true biblical authority obviously comes from God. And so that's where husbands, where we have to step up and we lead our families in authority as Christ leads us in authority. Mm-hmm. And as we follow and submit ourselves to godly authority that we have been placed under, you know, here at Calvary, it's our pastor and our bishop. Placing ourselves under that authority gives us that authority.
Yes.
And so when, and you do, like there is that, like you were saying, that sense of like, when you're not feeling it, there's that feeling of wanting to demand it. Mm-hmm. But again, that goes back to like, just as damaging as the nitpicking is,
yes,
like demanding authority in a situation is just as damaging.
No.
And so, okay. So like the authority side of things, that in a practical standpoint in a marriage looks as easy as when he makes a good decision for the family,
yeah,
recognize like, it, call it out. Like, hey, thanks for doing that and saving us some money. Or, hey, thanks for doing that. That was the right call. That was the right decision that we needed to make. And when he makes a bad decision, because guess what? He's human.
He's going to make a bad decision.
Be gracious.
Yeah.
Be gracious and forgiving with it.
Yeah.
Don't hold it over his head.
Yeah.
You know, don't even use it as a weapon to not trust him in the future.
Mm.
You know?
Well, bringing it up over and over. Women do tend to have a problem with constantly rehashing the past.
Coming back to it. Yeah. And so you bring it in a humble way. Does that mean you just need to act like it didn't happen? Again, approach it in a humble and loving way with respect.
Absolutely.
Of like, hey, can we talk about what happened? Like, I just, you know, I want to know from my side of like what just happened with mm-hmm. that. Okay. And so that's what that authority piece looks like.
Yeah.
And all of that, like wrapping it in, okay, of the relationship side of things. And this is where a lot of this is as we're talking about the pink and blue glasses that we brought up in the first episode of this. Men and women look at things very differently because we are just very different. And relationship connection with a man it can be very different. And men oftentimes, more times than not, connect through shared activity.
Mm-hmm.
And so in a dating relationship, that looks like going to the bowling alley and then going and getting ice cream. That looks like going golfing or whatever the case is. Men have business meetings on golf courses,
mm-hmm.
you know, in unconventional places. And like shooting ranges, whatever the case is, it's that shared activity. They bond and they connect. I mean, women have tea parties, men go camping.
Yeah.
You know, it is a feminine and masculine thing, but really what it is it's from the women's side, it's intimately connecting through conversation.
Well, you're eye to eye. It's when women connect, they're usually more eye to eye contact.
Right.
And sharing deep emotions and deep thoughts and dreams and plans, and they're energized by that. Whereas a man is energized by doing a shared activity,
fishing,
going, standing side by side and having a like one common goal that you're working toward.
Right. And so in the dating relationship, it's very easy to emulate that and do that. I mean, that's how you start your relationship and build it more often than not, is going out on those dates, connecting, and then going dinner and connecting the way that mm-hmm. the woman feels a way of connection. But then when you get married, it seemingly both of those kind of drop off because you end up being in the same house. Life happens. You go about
it. You ate supper together.
You talk, whatever the case is, but maybe. Yeah. But all of that kind of drops off. And now we're not saying that, well, you need to set a Tuesday night bowling or whatever the case is. It can look as simple as going for a walk around the neighborhood. If you have young kids, it can look as simple as playing a board game together while mm-hmm. they're jumping in their jumper, or just some kind of shared activity that you can even just have casual conversation through.
Mm-hmm.
A man will feel deeply connected through that shared activity.
I would say, and you can correct me if I'm wrong, it's not even that you feel connected. It's that your brain can actually function flow
that's
with processes that you wouldn't be able to if you're just sitting staring at each other on a couch. Like, you are actually able to function better when you are moving and working and doing things.
Right. And so all of this, okay, so the relationship side, shared activity, conquest, conquering things, hierarchy, authority, all of this stuff. One of the common grounds that we have found, and even in our relationship, that has been the most damaging is hurtful words.
Mm-hmm.
It's those little things of criticism. It's those little pieces, those little moments, as you said earlier, you know, calling him out in front of people or whatever the case is. Scripture says death and life is in the power of the tongue. The words that you speak can either bring death to your marriage, death to your husband, or it can bring life.
Yes.
And that life, what it looks like, is little things here and there. Mm-hmm. It's the, you know, saying thank you for all you do. Hey, I really appreciate how you did this. Hey, the lawn looks good. Just little things can begin to speak life just as much as those little bits of criticism will bring death.
Yes,
it will. Absolutely will bring death.
Before again and again and again.
Yeah. So speak life, and it happens just a little bit at a time, and you will gain momentum, and it becomes easier. And now all of a sudden you have a life marriage filled with flourishing.
Even, I wasn't even thinking your children, like implement it with your sons. Like you will notice a difference when they feel like you are proud of them and support their masculinity, because that's their natural makeup and their brain.
Yeah. And that is the easiest way to identify it, because I can hear in my mind ringing my sons, Camden and Easton. Hey, Dad, does the lawn look good?
Yeah.
Hey, Mom, what did you think about this?
They need the affirmation.
They need that affirmation of that effort that they put forward was not for naught.
Well,
and it was recognized and respected.
I'll even say, like, when you leave on your work trips, and I've told Camden before, like, okay, bud, like, if anybody breaks in, you're going to have to be our protector. I'm being dumb. Obviously, he's 8. But, and he bows up, and he's like, Mom, I got this.
That house. Yeah. He's going to die for it.
Serious. So, yeah. All right. So I hope you have learned a few things from today's podcast. If you have any questions or thoughts, like we want you to ask. Please don't feel like you are doing this alone. We haven't really even covered read the book, because the book has so much more depth. We have scratched the surface of really what is.
And next podcast, we will explore the women's side of things. And we husbands, we need you to listen to that one as well.
Yes, it is for both parties.
Right.
So build the momentum. Okay, so I would love to see each couple sit down and discuss what we've talked about today. How, as a wife, have I most respected you in the past? Or how do you feel most respected? What is something that like just really motivates you, encourages you in the respect department?
Yeah.
And on the flip side, what do I do? Is there anything that I do regularly that you feel disrespected from? And your job, wife, is to sit there and listen, internalize it, grow from it, and say, thank you. And that is it.
And that's it.
No arguments, what is it called? Defensiveness.
Right.
Because sometimes we really need to hear what we could do better and how we could grow, because there's a lot of times we're doing things we don't even really realize we're doing.
Right.
So for the game, we have producer Kristen is going to set a timer for 4 seconds on the first round. We have to say one random fact about our opponent, which is obviously.
I thought we were spouses, not opponents. I thought we were on the same team.
Tomato, tomato. Okay. So our spouse.
Okay.
So I will be saying something about you.
A random fact
in 4 seconds. One. And then you're going to the next round, just do 3 seconds, like up at 3 seconds, the next round, 2 seconds, if we even get to the next one.
And then we add a random fact to each one.
And so each time we add a random fact.
So we have to say, okay.
You ready?
No.
Okay, I'm going to go first.
Yes, please go first.
Okay, you retain information a lot better. So actually, I feel like I'm going to just try to be quick and it's going to be ridiculous. So.
Think of like good, juicy stuff.
Okay. That will definitely tie me up. All right.
Go.
You are wearing pants.
I thought we were saying random facts.
Like, that is a random fact.
No, it's not. That's a very obvious fact. Boy, this is going to be easy. You have hair. You're wearing a skirt.
Stop it. Okay. All right. I'll try again. Okay. Random fact. Wow. My mind is I know I'm overthinking it.
You're thinking about the time too.
I know. And my heart rate is like extremely. Okay. Ready? Go. You were 19 when we got married.
Okay. That's a good one. Wow. You made it by the skin of your teeth.
I know. What am I going to do too?
Okay.
Ready?
Yeah. Go. You wanted to be a punk rocker when you were a kid.
Yes, I did.
Okay, hold on. So round two, we're going to up it to 7 seconds.
3 seconds.
Right?
Yes.
Okay, ready?
Okay.
Go.
You were chased by an alligator when you were a kid.
Okay.
And you actually do not like playing golf.
Fair. I like it when other people pay for me, too. But I'm really bad at it, so no, I don't like playing.
Ready?
It's a good... No, I'm not. Okay.
Go.
You grew up in Crane, Texas, which is still population 3,000 people, and you love pizza.
Oh, okay.
Whew. That was very random. Oh,
man, I didn't think you were going to get it, so no, I was ready to win.
Now we're at 9 seconds?
Right.
7, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. Yeah, let's do 9, and now we have to say 3.
3 things.
3 things in 9 seconds.
Ready?
Okay.
Go.
You have had braces. Your sister had a baby today, and you like the color blue. Right? We're all those.
Oh, my goodness, you did it. I was like, no, that's not. Wow, that's incredible.
Okay.
Okay, ready?
No, hold on, please.
Set.
Please. No, hold on 1 second. Hold on.
1 second. One. Go.
You worked as a waitress in high school. You wear a size 9 shoe. Oh, no, I said that to everybody. And you don't have any gray hair.
I have 1, so that was a lie.
Oh, man.
Or 1 that I know of. Are we going to count that?
You don't have a gray hair.
Okay, all right. It's 9, 10 seconds. 5 things?
4.
4.
4 things in 10 seconds?
Okay, all right.
Ready, set, go.
Okay, you never played sports in high school.
Yeah,
you worked at Chili's.
Yeah.
You have worked at Best Buy. This doesn't seem fair. Okay, and you.
Okay, now I got to try. Okay, I'm going for the win.
All right.
4 things, going for the win.
Ready?
Yeah.
Okay.
The place that you worked at in high school burned to the ground is now just a
yeah, don't explain.
Okay, yeah. No, I'm done. I can't think of anything else. That was it.
You got caught done. Up in the explanation. Yeah,
you explained more than I did. You won that one. Congrats.
Yay! All right.
Give it up for my opponent for winning that round.
I'm your spouse. Thank you.
Well, thank y'all so much for taking the time joining us. We hope you enjoyed this podcast. If you have any feedback you want to share with us, you can email us at marrieds@calvaryokc.church. We'd love to hear any feedback that you do have. We love you guys. We pray for y'all all the time. We know that your marriage is going to win, and we truly believe that. God's behind it. We're behind it.
Put God first.
Yeah, put God first in your relationship, and you will flourish. Absolutely flourish. Remember, marriage is not what you can get out of it. It's what you can put into it. God bless.